Hey everybody, thank you for joining. This is our first 2022 online meetup in Washington, D.C. So today we have Oleg with us. Oleg already has the slide up. Oleg is CTO of Kubler, and he's also one of the organizers helping us maintain and present in these meetups. So and then you guys are also welcome to, talk to us and present your sessions, or if you have any other folks that you, or if there are any topics that you are interested in hearing about, please let us know as well. So let's keep this two ways. For today's session, I would like to welcome again Oleg. And Oleg, if you're ready, let's get started.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the introduction. So I will keep the introductions short. So just who we are, what we are doing. That meetup we are organizing is dedicated to everything around Kubernetes and various tools to run on Kubernetes, various techniques and CI/CD around Kubernetes. And one of the reasons why we are participating is that, well, as a part of Kubler, we are working on a tool set that helps to deploy Kubernetes and provision Kubernetes clusters in multiple environments. And as developers of such a tool, well, people rarely need Kubernetes when they don't have anything to run on that, right? So as developers of tools for Kubernetes, we often face extension projects where we help our clients to build whole stacks of technology on top of Kubernetes, around Kubernetes, et cetera, et cetera. And the most interesting for me, personally at least, projects are related to various complex solutions that span different layers, infrastructure, middleware, data, hybrid architectures. And for some time, I think data, dealing with data in those complex architectures and setups is probably, again, the most complex and interesting topic, which is why we tried to find sort of a good, if not baseline, but good universal solution that could work on different infrastructures and in different environments and help manage data in different scenarios with cloud-native applications in hybrid architectures. So, and after a few tries with a few projects where we worked with different systems and frameworks, we decided to focus on a tool set called Ceph and Druk. And this presentation essentially is where I will try to show how Ceph and Druk help deal with data in cloud-native applications. And my main goal, sort of overarching goal here, is just to show how powerful this is. I won't be able definitely to describe all the capabilities of this stack and the whole power that you get when you deploy it. But I at least will try to show you that, albeit the system on the first sight may seem complex, So that it actually may be easily deployable. It's quite a mature solution that allows you to deal with data in various scenarios. And that can be essentially fun to work with. And so for this presentation, what I did, I tried to set up a demo environment that, while not full-blown sort of enterprise environment, but it does reflect some of the complexities that you may face in real-life projects. Like, first of all, it's a hybrid architecture, heterogeneous infrastructure. So I used Kubler to provision a couple of Kubernetes clusters, one running on Azure, another running on AWS. And by the way, so I'm talking about Kubler here, but I only use Kubler as a Kubernetes provisioner. Kubernetes clusters that are provisioned here are, well, completely standard Kubernetes clusters. So there is nothing Kubler specific about them in context of what we are going to talk about. So the same presentation or the same tools and stacks would work on pretty much any other Kubernetes cluster. So you might have AKS here and EKS here, for example. You don't have to use Kubler to provision those clusters. Of course, with some differences in how you do that. So all the code and the procedures we are going to go through in this demo are on our GitHub account, so GitHub Kubler hybrid demo. So visit that, please check this demo there. It includes those clusters specifications. So you can use those specifications with free Kubler demo that is downloadable from our website to provision those clusters. Or again, as I said, you can just skip the first part of the instructions and provision your own clusters. And as soon as you have those clusters and config kubeconfig files for those clusters, you can then just go through the process using your own clusters. So we have those two clusters. One thing that is specific to Kubler here is actually that I made a quick shortcut and deployed some of the Helm packages that comprise the stack I'm going to talk about, Ceph, Rook, and Submariner as a VPN connection between clusters. I deployed them as a part of the Kubler cluster specification. So here, if we check the Kubler cluster specification, I'll skip infrastructure related part and I'll go directly to the part where I configure software Helm packages deployed into those clusters. So you may see here that cluster specs include Submariner broker already deployed there, some initialization scripts for Rook and Ceph that are deployed into those clusters, and the Rook and Ceph operator Helm package, and the Rook and Ceph cluster itself. So the final result of applying this cluster spec to, or using this cluster spec with Kubler is actually, so this Kubernetes cluster where we already have those three components deployed, Submariner operator and Rook Ceph components to manage data there. But again, so if you are using other clusters, you can just deploy those Helm packages according to documentation on corresponding components websites, and you can use this configuration as a reference. Now, having said that, let's go back to the presentation, and so I'll talk a little bit in more detail about what we are deploying there, and what I'm going to demo. And the first and foremost, so as I said, it's two Kubernetes clusters running, one on AWS, another on Azure. Let me see. So yes, and we set up a Submariner. It's a open source rancher, IPsec or VPN, generally speaking, solution that connects those clusters together, at least network connectivity, secure network connectivity is established so that pods in one cluster can talk with pods in another cluster. So we deploy CEF Rook package that sets up the storage clusters in each of these clusters. Like a cherry on the cake is that those clusters and so both Kubernetes clusters and CEF and Rook clusters inside those Kubernetes clusters are configured in valid high availability architectures. So each of these clusters is spanning three availability zones. On AWS, it's A, B, and C. On Azure, they just number those zones, 1, 2, and 3. But most importantly, each of those zones host its own raw disks, Azure disks on Azure and EBS disks on AWS. And those disks are used as raw storage for CEF and Rook data pools. And on top of those data pools, the whole cloud native storage system and stack is built. So I won't stop much on these slides talking about operators and Submariner specifically, because it's not the main focus of this demo. Let me switch directly to Rook and CEF architecture. So just to introduce it a little bit and explain what CEF is and what Rook is and what different components comprise those tools. So just as I said, CEF is a storage system. Originally, it wasn't intended for cloud-native environments. Well, maybe it's not intended for cloud-native environments even now by itself. But we'll go into cloud-native area when we will talk about Rook. Now, CEF by itself is a general-purpose storage system. It consists, when it's fully up and running, it consists of a bunch of different types of components. And the core set of components is monitors, of course. So main, so this is the brain of a CEF cluster. So usually it's similar to etcd in Kubernetes. So monitors usually run in groups of odd number of members. It's one monitor is not highly available configuration, three monitors is highly available configuration, which can survive one monitor down, five monitors can survive two monitors down, etc. Standard quorum model is used for monitors, and they have their own data storage, which doesn't have to be fast or large. It's just meta data storage. So monitors together use consensus algorithm to essentially provide metadata and coordination information and services to the whole cluster. Another type of components is OSDs. So OSD is essentially a data service in CEF cluster. OSD can have one or more data block devices usually, where which it formats in its own format, and it uses them to store data. So OSDs register in the monitors, and essentially they provide raw storage to the cluster. And based on those OSDs, so-called data pools are built. So you can, using monitors and various management tools for CEF, you can define one or more data pools. And let me make it a little bit more visual. So before going back to this presentation, explaining different components, let me guide you through first sections of our demo project, explain how this environment is set up. So, describe some prerequisite, you deploy the cluster. If you deploy the cluster with Kubler, so you will have already some components running there. So for both clusters, you need to save kubeconfig files. And I have here my command line where I already set those kubeconfig files up. So we can check that it works. Right now it's configured for AWS cluster, but I also have a Azure cluster config here. So the next few sections are dedicated to setting up connectivity between clusters and connecting those clusters using Submariner VPN. I already did that. We won't go through this. So what's interesting here is this section, which I want to run. And this section is a couple of commands, kubectl commands that extract CEF cluster dashboard connection information. So each of those clusters has its own endpoint published for AWS on EBS or on ELB. And for Azure, it's just plain IP address. And we can use these credentials to log into CEF user interface running for CEF clusters running in those clusters. So, and here we can see, so this guy, this UI shows us CEF in AWS cluster. This UI shows us CEF in Azure cluster. So, and looking at this cluster, we can see all those components I'm talking about. So essentially, like, for example, we can check which hosts comprise this cluster. So we see here that this is AWS cluster, and we see three cluster nodes here. For Azure cluster, there are three Azure nodes. We can check here. We also can see which components of CEF cluster are running on which host. You see that there is a monitor C running on this node, monitor B running on this node, and monitor A running on this node. We also have OSD here, here, and here. And we have some other components. Yes, please.
Can I ask you to make the screen a bit bigger?
Oh, right.
You zoom in a bit. Oh, it's much better. Much better. Thank you.
And I will do the same here.
Yeah.
Very good point. You can see this complex structure are shown in the user interface, and visualization and user interface is not a small feat for software adoption. So it is much easier, and you feel much more essentially confident managing a software when you can visualize it. So the fact that Ceph out of the box has this nice user interface is a great big deal. Now let's skip here the section where I connect the clusters, because I already did that. Checking intercluster interpod connectivity. Let's get back to our presentation. So these monitors, these data components is essentially the heart and the core of the cluster capabilities. So these essentially physical components, physical storage components together allow you to define logical data pools. So we can check it here. In the section pools, you see a number of, or to be exact, 11 pools are already defined here. And most of them are auxiliary system pools. Not most of them, actually. So some of them are system pools. Others back various services that Ceph cluster can provide to you. And the first one, Ceph block pool here, is actually the most basic one. It's actually a block device pool where you can create block devices images. Two other pools, Ceph file system data and Ceph file system metadata, back so-called Ceph file system. And a few more pools that have object store RGV prefix, back Ceph object storage. And then there is one pool, auxiliary system pool that stores health metrics. So let's go back to our presentation and talk about other components. So I already mentioned, so Ceph allows you to not only provide storage in form of block devices. So block devices are usually, it's like your EBS is an example of block device, or Azure Data Disk is an example of block device, or any iSCSI connected drive, for example, is a block device. So block devices are usually dedicated devices, so you cannot have multiple clients talking to the same block device in most cases, or you have to use some special kind of software that can coordinate changes to that block device by itself, which is why this may be a significant limitation, which is why Ceph provides a Ceph file system. So Ceph file system, or CephFS, is a network connected file system similar conceptually to NFS that allows multiple clients to connect to it and work with volumes, shared volumes. And this Ceph file system is provided by components called MDS in Ceph. Under the hood, those MDS components just store the data, the files on some data pools, and that's exactly what we saw here. So these two data pools are used by MDS components to store internal data for this Ceph file system. And another service that Ceph provides is Object Store. So it's S3 compatible. You can use S3 or Swift-like API to store objects in Ceph. It's implemented using with RGW components in Ceph. And again, RGW daemon uses OSD data pool to store this data and expose it as objects through S3 API. There is also NFS service in Ceph provided by Ganesha components. So, and again, Ganesha is backed by either MDS or directly data pools. So, and other two types of components provide system services, like manager allows you to manage the cluster and provide various additional plugins. And by the way, this user interface is implemented as a Ceph plugin and provided by this manager component. And RBD Mirror is a daemon or service in Ceph that is intended to provide mirroring services. So you can connect two Ceph clusters and configure mirroring between them. Now, all this nice and good if you are ready to manage it directly, but it would be difficult if you had to work with those disks and all those services in Kubernetes, just manually configuring them. So Rook essentially is a set of components built on top of Ceph. So Rook is not part of Ceph. Rook is a separate project. It uses Ceph as a storage system. And Rook provides a set of components that integrate Ceph with Kubernetes, that allows you to use Kubernetes objects to manage Ceph objects and to work with Ceph objects and to work with Ceph disks. So, and we'll just go through a set of simple use cases showing how it works in Kubernetes with Rook and Ceph. So, let me skip these slides. They talk about how this cluster specifications are structured, and it's not really a focus of this meetup today, and we don't have enough time to really talk about that in details. So let me stop for a minute on this slide, which helps us to recall how persistence conceptually works in Kubernetes. So in most cases, irrespective of what actual storage you use, whether it's EBS disk on AWS or Ceph underlying your storage. So Kubernetes uses a more or less standard set of objects to work with this storage. So your pod uses so-called persistent volume claims to express its requirement, its storage requirements. So you create persistent volume claims in your namespace. And then there may be different scenarios on how those claims are satisfied. In most cases, standard practice today is to use automatic provisioning. So there is a component running in Kubernetes that listens for new volume claims, and if it sees that there is a volume claim that is not satisfied, it does something. Usually it looks at a so-called storage class which the volume claim refers, and a different storage class may describe different types of storage. You may have different, for example, a storage class for Ceph in your cluster, and at the same time a different storage class for EBS disks in your cluster. And by pointing your volume claim at different storage classes, you can tell which type of storage you need. So provisioner looks and sees that there is a new volume claim object, and it does provisioning of actual storage in the underlying storage, like create an EBS volume or create a Ceph volume. And then it creates a Kubernetes object pointing at this actual storage, and that Kubernetes object is called persistent volume. And then it binds this persistent volume to the volume claim. This is when a pod can actually start and start working with this actual storage. So that's exactly the scheme that Rook implements when it integrates when it integrates CF with Kubernetes. So Rook consists of several operators. We won't go into a lot of details talking about how they work, but just generally speaking, what you can do with CF. So first of all, you can register storage classes for block storage and for CF file system, and then use this standard approach by creating persistent volume claims, pointing in these storage classes for Rook to provision corresponding storage and create persistent volumes. CF also introduces some CF specific objects like CF block pool and CF file system, so that by creating those CF block pools and CF file system objects, you can make Rook to provision whole data pools and whole CF file system. And why this may be important is because this way you can actually operate your storage. You can define different data pools with different characteristics for different needs, because when you create a new data pool, for example, there is a lot of parameters that you can specify in CF. You can specify different replication parameters for the data. You can enable erasure coding for those pools. You can define limits, quotas, etc., etc. So, and those CF block pool and CF file system objects in Kubernetes allow you to do that through Kubernetes API using kubectl. Okay, now let me skip mirroring for now and let's start with something simple. So let's start with just an example of application which consumes these different types of CF storage. Our clusters were deployed and storage classes were already created in them with CF file system type and with CF block type for pools. So I will just use this command line from my demo project and will provision again. So what I'm doing here, I'm just creating a persistent volume claim and a deployment. And persistent volume claim is pointing at a CFFS storage class. And you may notice that in our AWS cluster, we immediately got two pods started because this deployment is with two pods. We can check here PVC. There is the PVC that was created based on my request. Based on that PVC created, a persistent volume was provisioned. With CF file system type, we can actually now go to CF UI and check what happens there with our file systems. We may notice that in our file system, it allows us to browse the file system. We will notice that there is a directory where a subvolume was created. So CF file system starts with a common root always, and within that common root you can create various subvolumes that have different characteristics, so you can define different quotas and you can snapshot subtrees in that tree. So Kubernetes and Druk uses this fact to provision multiple volumes by essentially defining different paths in this tree. So this is a shared file system, and we already can see that we have two pods that share this file system, and they connected connected the same volume. So if we so we can create some file there in the mounted path, at mntfs path, and then see, for example, if we go into console for the first pod, check this file is accessible there. And we can go to console in the second pod and check that this is indeed a shared file system and the same file is accessible there. So in a very similar manner, we can do, we can create a new block device and an application, and create an application that consumes that block device. With the only difference from application standpoint that I'm not creating two pods here, I am only creating one pod. If I tried to create two pods here using the same block device, one pod would be permanently pending because only one pod can consume a block device. Now, in my user interface in our CEF cluster, we can go to block device view, and we will see that there is indeed a new image created recently in our CEF block pool pool. With certain parameters, and we can control all those parameters through Kubernetes objects that we use to provision this pod. And this pod, this persistent volume claim, it's consumed by this new application that we created. Now, what can we do with those images? So if it was just consumptions of images and management of images, it wouldn't be that fun. But as CEF allows you to do some advanced things like snapshotting, creating images from snapshots, and the same works for file systems. You can snapshot a whole subtree in the file system, and you can copy a new subtree from a snapshot, et cetera, very quickly and very efficiently. So you can do the same using Kubernetes. So like, for example, here, what we can do, and we do that using a special type of objects in Kubernetes called snapshot. So, and a snapshot class. So snapshot class, again, as usual in Kubernetes, defines a set of parameters that are useful for group operations. And snapshot directs underlying storage that you want to create a snapshot from that disk. And then when you create a new PVC, another PVC, you can optionally point at that snapshot as a source, so that a new persistent volume will be created as that from that snapshot. So, and this is exactly what we do here. So we do it. We create a new volume snapshot for the file system, and it tells us, hey, there is a snapshot class we created there, and we create a new snapshot. We can check that this snapshot is really there, the object I need. Kubernetes object. Let's update some content on the disk there. Now let's see how it looks in Ceph. So because we did that in file system, we need to go to file system, navigate to our volume. And we will notice that, hey, at this point in the tree, which corresponds to our volume, we have a snapshot created, so which is ready to be used to recover the disk. The same works for block devices. So we can create a new snapshot object for our block disks. We can see that this snapshot created as a Kubernetes object. Here it is, 9 seconds ago. Let's just for fun update some content on the disk after snapshot was created. And we can check how it looks in user interface. If we go to images, this is our image corresponding to that disk. And now we can see that there is a snapshot created for that disk. And there can be any number of those snapshots, and they're efficient, they're iterative. So they don't, you saw how quick the snapshot creation was. And now we can create another persistent volume, which the only difference from the one we created before for the first application is that we put data source in the volume definition. And we are telling that Kubernetes that data source, so that snapshot should be used as a data source. So if you do this, you will notice that there is a new PVC created, and then there is a new application consuming that PVC is created. And now we can check whether they have different file content. Those applications do indeed contain different content. So this guy, the original application, has changed content, and the new application that was created from the snapshot has old content there. So the same works exactly, almost exactly the same code works for block devices. So we create a new PVC, we point it at a snapshot as a source, and it creates a new disk from that snapshot. We can see it here. Let's refresh it. So now we see there are two disks, and one of them must have as a parent our original snapshot. Another interesting thing that you can do is volume cloning. And volume cloning is almost the same as creating snapshot and recreating disks. The only difference is that as a data source, you specify another existing disk already. Here, another way to create a copy of your application is just to create a PVC from an existing PVC. So, and on a diagram, it would look like that. So essentially you create PVC pointing at an existing PV, and the new PV is created as a clone of existing PV. And again, it's all efficient and quick. So new application is created in a matter of seconds. So this is for file system, and the same works for block storage. And we have 10 minutes left. Actually, if you have questions, please ask. We can talk about some aspects of what we, of this presentation in more details. I just wanted to show one more thing, the most complex thing in this presentation. because of which I actually deployed two clusters. Everything I showed so far could be done with one cluster, but I have two clusters because I wanted to show how mirroring works in RULC-CF. And just to explain it conceptually, so on the CF level, you can use RBD mirror daemons to connect data pools and establish essentially asynchronous image replay between those data pools. RULC supports it by allowing you to specify corresponding parameters in those CF block pool objects on Kubernetes level. So if you, for example, enable mirroring in this CF block pool object in Kubernetes, mirroring will be enabled in the corresponding pool. So here, if you check, we will find here in the configuration that, I'm not sure actually where to find it, but looking hard enough, we could find here that mirroring is enabled for this pool. And going to mirroring view in this cluster, we will notice that two daemons are running, and there are two of them for failover, for high availability. And those daemons understand that this CF block pool is enabled for mirroring, and it's in a good state and ready for mirroring. And the same shows in the other cluster. So there is the same block pool, and it's also enabled for mirroring. It's just there are no mirrored images yet there. You will notice if you analyze this demo project. So here in the beginning, after we set up VPN connection between clusters, there are a few scripts that enable this mirroring between clusters. So first of all, we enable it on the block pools, and then we set up peering because it's not simple sort of enable. You have to tell those pools where to go and how to connect and various security tokens to peer them. But fortunately, it's easily scriptable, and it's just a few commands eventually that provides all those secrets and establish cross trust between those pools. And now, after this is done, you can check mirroring status using kubectl command. So we can do it here. So we can see that in both clusters, daemon health is okay and mirroring health is okay, so they are ready for mirroring. Now let's deploy another application in our AWS cluster. So that's again a simple application that just this time it you in an infinite loop, it just writes a date into a file on the block device every 2 seconds. Now these pools are configured to not mirror images automatically. So you need to enable mirroring on each image individually that you want to mirror. There is an option to enable automatic mirroring, but I didn't use it here. Now, for RULC to enable mirroring means that, you need to create a special object, Kubernetes object, called volume replication that points at the volume that you want to replicate. So let's do that. So I created volume replication, and let's see how it reflects on CF. Here's our this is our cluster, and you will notice that this image now moved into this section in the mirroring UI. And it's marked as primary there. We could also go to our Azure cluster, and we will notice that this same image immediately appeared there in that cluster pool in the mode replaying. And that's exactly what we would expect here. So we marked image as mirrored, and it was mirrored to another cluster. Now we can check volume replication status in Kubernetes. That's easy. We can see that the main condition here is status true. Type completed status true means that mirroring is enabled and it works. Let's update some data in that application in Azure cluster. So we actually put a string hello world one into that file, and now we see that the application prints this value every 2 seconds. Now, why you are doing this? Probably for backup and disaster recovery. So what if we want now to switch to Azure cluster? So first of all, we need to prepare everything in Azure for that. So we need to have a similar structure in Azure cluster ready to be started. We cannot have another application running there actively, because you remember block devices are usually single user devices. So if we let this application to modify this image, it wouldn't be able to merge changes coming from here and from here. So this application will be in a standby mode. It will be created there, but with zero replicas. And this script, yep.
So Oleg, a quick question. Volume replication, is that like a Kubernetes thing, or is that the CRD added by the Rook operator?
Implementation is Ceph.
Okay.
Rook allows you to manage this implementation using Kubernetes objects.
Okay.
So Kubernetes itself is not aware of any low-level data operations. So it is just a framework which developers used to provide all those control objects, volume replication, cell block pool, et cetera, et cetera. And actual integration with Ceph functionality, with mirroring, is done by Rook operators.
So for example, volume snapshotting, cloning, that's just part of the CSI spec, the CSI sig, right?
Yes.
But replication is not. You're saying replication is actually a very specific feature in Ceph. Right.
Yes, exactly. Okay. So you're right. In that sense, volume snapshotting, cloning, it's part of CSI spec, but it's not part of CSI spec as an implementation. It's just a control structures. They were standardized, but implementation is actually storage specific. Replication is similar in the sense that it's storage specific. It's different in the sense that it hasn't yet been standardized. I expect that at some point it also will become a CSI, part of CSI spec.
Okay.
There are actually working group working.
Can we have a way, is there a way in Ceph to, instead of sending it to another cluster, I can maybe upload it to like an S3 bucket and then download S3?
Very good question, actually. So let's see how our mirroring is working. So we can use these capabilities to implement BCDR, backup and disaster recovery, but it is not part of Ceph per se. So Ceph doesn't have special functionality that would allow you to send this data to S3, for example. It can only send this data to another Ceph cluster. But you can use frameworks like Velero, for example, a great BCDR framework. And Velero works with any storage that supports snapshotting and cloning and snapshot recovery. So it works great with Ceph as well. And Velero can, for example, schedule regular snapshot creation and then archiving that snap data from that snapshot and sending it to S3 using iterative different algorithms. Okay, so now what we did here, we actually copied a bunch of objects like persistent volume claim, that volume replication object, and the deployment itself from our Azure cluster. So this set of objects was copied from Azure cluster, from AWS cluster to Azure cluster with minor changes. Those minor changes include this pod scaling down to zero. So now switching to AWS is quite simple. So if we are doing the control switching, we can just scale our AWS application down to zero and mark this volume replication object as secondary. You see our pod is stopping, and we can check in our mirroring UI in AWS cluster that okay, our image went to unknown state, which really means that in our image pair there are no primary at the moment. The other image in the other cluster, in the Azure cluster, also became unknown because there are two images and none of them is primary. And now we can just promote Azure to production by making the replica primary and scaling the application up. So let's do that. And we see the application starting there and it's already running actually. And here Ceph will reflect this change in status in a few seconds. So yeah, now you see in AWS Ceph cluster, our image went to replaying status and our Azure image went to primary status. And we can check what happened there. We can change the content and switch back, and we will see that it works in both directions. Probably we don't have much time left, so I think I'm ready to questions.
Hey, Oleg, we have somebody who commented that they wanted a recording. I just uploaded the link to our YouTube channel. You can also find recording by visiting our community.cncf.io/washington-dc page. Once the recording is uploaded to YouTube, I'll link it up there where we can have slides and the presentation. So, and if you have more questions, you can also find us on our Slack channel, which is going to be, if you go to slack.kubernetes.io, you sign up there and then look for hashtag meetupdc. This is the channel and then meetupdc is the channel if you want to find us on Slack. All right, questions.
Well, I see Neil threw his out there, so I'll let you take his first.
There is a question from Neil. We have a Red Hat team managing OpenShift on-prem on our project. We have Ceph for object storage and Ceph for persistent volumes. Are these the same? In a sense, So OpenShift is a Red Hat version of Kubernetes, or Red Hat, not version, distribution of Kubernetes. Ceph clearly a, well, while it's open source project, it's mainly Ceph sponsored, or sorry, Red Hat sponsored project. And Red Hat sells Ceph and services around it. So they manage Ceph clusters in your setup. Although I'm not sure whether they deploy it in Kubernetes or they deploy it directly on hardware, for example. Both options are possible. If they deploy it in Kubernetes, it's using Rook, most probably. If they deploy on hardware, it's using native Ceph installers. Either way, you can use this Ceph as persistent volumes in your Kubernetes / OpenShift clusters. So while I focused on usage of Rook as both deployer of Ceph in Kubernetes and adapter of Ceph for Kubernetes, Rook can also be used just to consume external Ceph cluster. So you can deploy Rook in a mod that it doesn't deploy really Ceph inside Kubernetes cluster, but it connects to external Ceph cluster and allows you to create persistent volumes in the same way I showed you, and do almost all the same things in that Ceph cluster through Kubernetes API. Hope I didn't obscure the question more than I answer. How to install Rook and configure with Kubernetes on-prem? I'm using VMware Workstation on testing. Yeah, so you can just go to Rook documentation, so and check how Ceph operator is installed using Helm charts. And there are a lot of parameters that you can configure there. And there are two charts actually that you need to deploy. First chart deploys a Ceph operator itself, but not yet a Ceph cluster. And another chart allows you to create a Ceph cluster object using which Ceph operator will provision all the Ceph cluster components. In my demo, in this demo published on our GitHub account.
Link off that, yeah, Hyperdash demo. It's in the comments up there. So definitely look it up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So yeah, but in this demo, so essentially what I wanted to say, both those charts are deployed as a part of Kubler cluster spec. What you see here is essentially this Rook Ceph operator Helm chart parameters and Rook Ceph cluster Helm chart parameters. Here essentially those clusters, that cluster configuration